Investor's Edge with Gary Kaltbaum. Straight talk about you and your money. Now from the BizTalk studios, here is Gary Kaltbaum.
And welcome once again to Investor's Edge. I'm Gary Kaltbaum, your host. Hey, thanks for being with us today. Glad you're here, ladies and gentlemen. Happy that you are listening. It's Friday. I think it's March 8th. It's 2024. Hope you're having a very good day. Ladies and gentlemen, lots to cover today. You know, when we describe for you, we're getting right into it, and we'll introduce ourselves later. When we discuss with you what we do, and it's technical analysis of the markets that a lot of people say doesn't work, and we love them, we try to be careful about how we convey it over the radio. And when we listen back to the show, we want to make sure we don't fly over your head. So we're very careful with our verbiage, our terminology, and the like. One of the big things we did here was on January 5th, where we said if NVIDIA breaks above 505, buy the heck out of it. We thought it was just a classic model book stock straight out of the Hall of Fame model books that O'Neill put together, Bill O'Neill, that I put together, and some of the other people that really know this business have put together. That's an easy way to explain. Now, recently, we have been telling you how unbelievably stretched and extended these moves are. We told you about our recent purchases that are up 10, 15% in 4 days, and we're not talking about small cap $3 stocks. And in my business, we have certain occurrences. They are characteristics that we try to discuss with you of the market showing us things are hitting a wall. One of the main ones happened today. Not for everything, but for the leading stocks in the leading group, for the most part. After a monstrous run in the semiconductors, in the AI, one of the main characteristics of when you're going to hit a wall is when everybody's getting in. And when we mean everybody, the last person. Now, we use that terminology, last person. It's not necessarily the last person, but it's indicative of buyers losing the upper hand. And let me just explain what happened today. The main name is NVIDIA, right? Right. It has had a monstrous run since the day we put it out. The last few days gapped up every day, and today did the same. Early on, it hit $974, almost a 100% move in just 2 months. It closed at $875, a 100-point drop off the highs. And volume was the biggest volume in many months. That is what is known as a key high volume exhaustion reversal. And typically what it means, and I want to be careful with this, the high of today typically will not be taken out anytime soon. That doesn't mean it closed at 875 today, that it rallies to 900 or 915 or 920. It's going to be very tough to get through the 975 again anytime soon. And odds favor, just odds favor, gonna have some work in here. The last time NVIDIA had a big run happened into August. It took 5 months before it broke out again. But in August, it really did not go that much climactic, though I will tell you, mid-August, you had a key reversal day on volume, which kind of hit the wall on the stock again for many months. Now, in order to get a triple, quadruple, a fivefold, a 10-bagger, the model books show you may have to go through things like this. So you get to decide on whether you want to keep. We're still up on initial position almost 80% in 2 months. Was more at the open today. Now that's NVIDIA. They pretty much did it with others too. Not as bad, but others that didn't have such good moves. The SOX today hit 5,200. The semiconductors closed at 49.57. The NASDAQ dropped 188. The NASDAQ 100, 279. But for me, the big characteristic of a huge key high volume reversal won the day for this area, not for everything. I can tell you, financials act pretty well and didn't budge today. I can tell you that. The Bitcoin was up again today. It's just these leading names in the semis slash AI. And you may want to look up the words exhaustion gap and study it. Simple as that. Now let me repeat again so you understand again. What it typically means, and there's nothing typical about this market, typically the high of today in these names going to be very tough to be taken out. AMD on the open, near the open today, hit 228 after breaking out at 185 6 days ago. Closed at 208. Still up 13% in 6 days. But this is what we mean by key reversals. And you can see it on a chart. You can see it in the volume. And we'll see what comes of it as we go into next week. Hope that explains it. Now, also, ladies and gentlemen, we're very careful also about who we follow. And there's not many. As you know, we kind of drown out the noise of the average person yapping away in the markets, because we have found out that many of them just, they don't know what the hell they're doing. And in bear markets, they're going to kill you. So we're always on the lookout for the best of the best. And as we have told you, anytime Stanley Druckenmiller talks, George Soros, David Tepper, Steve Cohen, though he talks more about the Mets now, we always want to hear from the greats. Some Bill O'Neill, who passed away, but Gil Morales, who we've had on the show, we're going to bring him on soon again. In a couple of minutes, I'm going to just give you a few names that you should be following on Twitter or X. They've proven to me they got game. And they've proven to me in good and bad markets. And that's the most important part of the equation. They've proven to me they have keen eyes. And by the way, I've never met them. They don't even know I'm bringing this up. But there are a few of them, and I must tell you, they disclose a lot more of what they do than I do. I'm very careful of saying what I do on Twitter and things like that. They actually tell you the moves they're making. So in a couple of minutes, I'm just going to give you out their handles or their names, and you go put their name into Twitter, and you can follow them, and you get to decide. And just so you know, we're not advertising them. They ain't paying me. I've never met them. I believe they follow me. I follow them. And that's it. And by the way, you should be following Gil Morales, without a doubt. That'll be in a couple of minutes. Now, of course, the State of the Union last night. Oh, yeah. Well, we did one hell of a dissertation or diatribe on our State of the Union yesterday. Next up, Joe Biden proved me right. That's up next on This the One Only Investor's Edge.
I'm Gary Kaltbaum, host of the nationally syndicated radio show Investor's Edge. We're not just handsome radio people. We manage investors' money for a living, specializing in fee-based discretionary money management. No big commissions, just a fee on the assets that's managed. We also provide a full range of personalized services, including retirement planning, fixed income, and educational needs, all to assist you in achieving your financial goals. Understanding not all individuals have the same needs, we'll carefully evaluate your personal goals to determine a proper investment strategy. If your current approach to investing is not getting you to where you would like to be, call us to make an appointment for a complimentary portfolio review. The number to call is 888-422-5559. That's 888-422-5559. That's 888-422-5559. Investment advisory services offered through Kaltbaum Capital Management.
It's time to switch on the integrator units and get the brain cells working.
You're listening to...
Hey, this promises to be fun.
Investor's Edge.
The last bastion of quality programming.
With Gary Kaltbaum.
It doesn't get better than this.
And welcome once again to Investor's Edge. Well, Joe Biden proved me right. He stood up there, and by the way, everybody's been concentrating on, oh, is he going to be show his age or not his age? I don't care if he's 150 years old. If he's got good policies and he doesn't lie to you, I'm happy with him. So I couldn't care less if he whined, cried, fell down, yelled, screamed, did not matter to me. It's what his policies are and what he had to say last night that I want to discuss. And he did not let me down. He's a lying sack of the highest order. And the shame of it is, this freaking media, and I use the word freaking because, man, oh man, do they suck. Remember when Trump was president? Every time he lied, they gave him a colonoscopy. Washington Post would list his lies. I think they came up with 10,000 of them. Whatever. Joe Biden, they don't even freaking touch. So let me call him out on his blatant, no question about it, lies. We created 15 million jobs. Nope. It's a lie. First, number one, we create the jobs. They don't create squat. But under his presidency, 10 million came back from COVID. Let's call it about 5 million. He said he lowered the deficit. $1 trillion. Lie. Lowered spending. Lie. The man supersized the government. Massive, over the top government spending and deficit spending beyond the beyond, beyond any imagination. to the point where we're now at $1 trillion a year in interest. Our tax dollars is going towards interest. The last 12 months, $2.7 trillion added to our debt. The man is a lying sack. He said, again, we lowered children's poverty rate by 50%. Lie. Do you know what the claim is? We gave a tax credit and it puts him over the poverty line. Lie. How do I know? I live that. Being on the board and being a part of the Boys and Girls Clubs of Central Florida, children do not come out of poverty because of a check. They come out of poverty because of a good education and mentorship and leadership and family. Big, fat, frickin' juicy lie out of this man. And he sickens me. And by the way, I'd say it straight to his face. Remember, I have no respect for any of these people. None. Zero. Imagine giving such great power and abusing the hell out of it. That's what they've done. They've abused you and I. Oh, by the way, the Republicans signed off on the last spending bill. But I digress. Aren't we just tired of it? And unfortunately, it's not going to change. The two biggest liars of this century are against each other for presidency. But the Trump people email me and say, yeah, mean tweets, but he had good policies. I sure hope so. If Trump wins, I hope I don't care what he says. I hope he comes in, defends the country, solidifies the border, keeps taxes low, regulations low, and then get the hell out of our way. That's what I hope. This guy, he ain't defending the border. His foreign policy sucks. His spending and deficits are a joke. Oh, by the way, Trump, let's back up. And lower the size of government and its spending, which he says he's going to do again, though he didn't do it last time. But back to Biden. I'd say it right to his face. You suck. I'm a big believer in opportunity. Imagine. You're the president of the United States, the leader of the free world, and you spend your days and nights lying out your butt to the American public while castrating the taxpayer to kingdom come. And then, business. You're bad. Businesses, you're gouging. Businesses, you're doing this, you're doing that. Lie. If a business's costs go up, they've got to raise prices. I don't know if you know this, but cocoa prices have soared in the last year. Guess what the chocolate companies have to do? Raise the prices. Duh. That is how it works, ladies and gentlemen. Just like if you go to the gas station, if oil prices skyrocket, you're paying more. If they come down, you're paying less. That's all. And of course, when they were going up, we heard it was the Putin price hike. When oil prices came down, oh, it's because it's me, Joe Biden. I'm the greatest. So the State of the Union for me was a farce. An unmitigating farce. And the reaction by the media, a farce. Fawning nincompoops. Oh, he was feisty. Oh, he was forceful. Clear and compelling. Forward-looking views. Kiss my forward-looking views. He's taken federal spending, the government, from $4.4 trillion to $7 trillion this year. And you know what else? If he has another 4 years, he'll go to 8, 9, 10. You know why? Because he's a Marxist dolt that use us as a slush fund. That is what they do. That's what Marxist socialists do. And they're very good at it. And that's our take on his State of the Union. ladies and gentlemen. Boeing. Holy crap. So a tire comes off of United Airlines, a Boeing 777, a 737 MAX just went off the tarmac. And I guess the landing gear went boom. Boeing. I don't know if... In 19, there were two crashes. Everybody died. Boeing, the 737. The way they responded was terrible. They had got a new CEO. And I don't know what the hell's going on there. And I think we're lucky. You know, when the door flew off, if they were higher in the air, that thing's gone. Up next, we'll cut that ribbon, then we'll hit the markets again. This is the one and only Investor's Edge.
You're listening to
America is Talking
Investor's Edge.
He's got to be pleased with that. The crowd is just on its feet here. Cinderella boy.
With Gary Kaltbaum.
Comes highly recommended. You're going to feel better if you talk to him.
Yeah, it was Ethiopian Airlines, and the other one was a Lion Air, I believe, that crashed in 18 and 19. 737 MAX plane. They had to redo and whatever. I don't know what the hell's going on there. I think as passengers, we're big time fortunate, but as for Boeing, first off, that door came off. If they were a little higher in flight, forget about it. One of the kids that was two seats away lost his shirt. And if somebody was in the next seat to the door, they were out the door. So I got news for you. I ain't invested in Boeing. And I got to tell you, with this going on, I was surprised it wasn't down $20 today. Down 4.5 today. It's like Murphy's Law with these dudes. I mean, where is the quality control? And I don't usually pick on, but I mean, we fly. I'm going on a Boeing Sunday again. I've never had a problem. Let's hope it stays that way for any and all. That was the Boeing. What else? So we'll do a webcast this weekend, and it'll be on breaking above a major trend line, which very often leads to exhaustion gaps. I put this out, by the way, last night to my peeps, and the next day it happened. The big open, the gargantuan reversal. Now, I will say this. There's all this rumor that NVIDIA is going to announce a split. If they announce a split and the stock gaps big, oh, I'm going to sell into that bad boy. That's a rumor. It was going around today. I don't believe it because nobody likes splitting their stocks anymore. Splitting stocks used to be the norm. Nobody cares about it anymore. So let me repeat again. Odds favor. We hit a moment. In the semis / AI. And right at that point where I put out last night to our peeps, watch out for an exhaustion gap type, and boom, the next day. Now, as I promised, Twitter, X, Roy Maddox. Never met him. Don't know him. I follow him. He's proven to me he's got game. M-A-T-T-O-X. And I believe he's like runs one of the Investor's Business Daily investing groups where they meet each month. You should follow him. Absolutely follow him. Over the top impressed with his discipline. Connor Bates. Connor Bates. Over the top impressed. Great eye. By the way, everybody I mentioned here, great eyes. And somebody who works at Connor Bates's firm, Ted Zhang. Z-H-A-N-G. You put those three names in, and their handle will come up, I gather. And you should follow them. And they do a lot more than me as far as disclosing. A lot more. But I have a very good eye for good eyes. And these three just impress the hell out of me. And I watch them big time. I have a few others, but I'll just do three at a time right now. But I did mention Gil Morales is a must. And he's funny as all hell. He suffers no fools, and I love that. And you know what I mean by that? There's just a manic crowd out there. You know, when you were in junior high and two kids would get one of these pushing fights, you know, those little pushing fights on the gym floor? There's a bunch of people on these social media sites are the kids that were on the sideline yelling, hit 'em, hit 'em. And always looking for somebody's mistakes. Instead of looking for people's successes and learning from them, always trying to rip on somebody. So when they try ripping on, when Gil sees it, oh, he just rips right back, and it's great to see. And again, one of the brilliant minds out there. And I'll tell you the one thing I love about Gil more than anything. The greatest triumphs can come from your rough times. And it's not very often we see it. I've seen so many people go through rough times that never come back because the emotion and psychology. We've all had our moments. Gil had his moment, and boom, right back. Love that. And by the way, freely talks about it. Love that. As I tell you here, there's no bigger critic of me than me. Anybody who comes at me, yeah, fine, good. Have a great day. Peace out. So that's the story on these three gentlemen. Go look them up. By the way, I think they all manage money. I really shouldn't say that because that's what I do for a living. But they all manage money. I think they really do well. Anyway, that's that. And I'll mention a few others in the days and weeks ahead. But I'm very picky. I am very, very picky. On the other end. So you had this monstrous move in these semiconductors and AI that left big tails today. What's a tail in the market? Well, when you plot them on a chart, you got a big bar, a big big vertical bar, and the horizontal, the finishing price, is at the low end or near the low end of the day. And volume's heavy. But what do I do now? I'm a smart guy. Doesn't stop me. I'm going to gauge, decide, think about it, look at position size, where I stand, what's the potential is, can they go much lower? Will I let them? Because knowing my last triple I had was Visa. I lived through some serious corrections where normally I'd stop out. But since I had so much cushion and I mean cushion, I went through the correction. Right now, so NVIDIA is down 100 points from the high today and finished down 50 today. But I'm still up 75% in 2 months. What if this is just a moment? And what if 3 months from now it breaks out again? Will I be ready? If I sell, will I be ready? The questions I'll be asking myself over the weekend while I'm visiting my parents, 92 and 90, which is quite the thrill. 92 and 90. I wonder if I'd ever get there. What else today? Broadcom was down almost 100 today. Keep in mind, it's a $1,300 stock. That was on earnings. And again, that has been one of the strong names in the area. You know what was up today? Apple was up $2. And you know why it was up? Because it's been down a lot. That's all. You got to bounce somewhere. I wouldn't take that because I got asked about it. Why is Apple up today when the market's getting hit? It's because it was down. I wouldn't go further than that. At gold, we told you about the breakout in gold. GLD at 194, closed at 201.63 in 4 days, up $1.69 today. So gold, launching pad. Up next, we'll wind up the week. I'm Gary. This is the one and only Investor's Edge.
You're listening to...
What are we waiting for?
Well, what are you waiting for?
One, two, ready, go.
Action! Investor's Edge with Gary Kaltbaum.
Da-da-da-da-da-da. And welcome once again to Investor's Edge. Whew. Wicked day today. But I've seen them all. I've experienced them all. So here is what I do this weekend. With no bias, because we have no bias, we'll scan the market. And we'll try to see, hey, while this is going on, what's happening elsewhere? Just a minute ago, I mentioned gold. Gold's on its way. How much, I don't know, and don't expect it to be like Bitcoin and stuff, but it's gone from 194 to 201.63, the GLD. This week, on the breakout. Just this week. And by the way, hit 203, I believe, today. It is now extended. It's stretched. It's overbought. Could pull back. I think we mentioned yesterday and the day before, a pullback towards that 196 looks to be buyable. Don't know if you're going to get it. We'll repeat that again. But as I do my scans, I'm looking for other things. Well, I take that back. It's not that I look for other things. They show up. Other things show up. And we'll let you know. The financials still act pretty darn well. Had a decent day today. Came off the highs because the market got trashed towards the end of the day. By the way, the Dow was only down 68, but the NASDAQ was down 188, the NASDAQ 100, 279. The SOX was down 208, and as mentioned, pretty rough day. Facebook, we own at 350, closed at 505, but it opened at 520. What do we do? Well, we own at 350, it's 505. What is it? It's almost 50%. In a matter of 8 weeks. We want to give it every chance. Why? We want doubles. We want triples. We want quadruples. And as we've been taught by the best, the only way is you're gonna have to live through corrections. And they ain't easy. Remember what we always tell you here. What we do ain't easy. It's a lot of work. It's not the guys that just put you into 100 stocks or 25 different mutual funds and just come hell or high water, you're in. And if you get into a bear market of down 40% and your account's down 40%, you know what they just tell you? Hey, don't worry, everything's okay. It'll come back, blah, 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 blah. And of course, they don't tell you that Citigroup's still down 95% from the year 2008. Intel's lower than where it was in the year 1999. And the list goes on and on of companies that are nowhere even longer around. They don't tell you that. We tell you things change. There's always new names. Anybody ever hear of Supermicro until the last year? Hell, I didn't. So what we're doing now, just what shows up, what else? Anything new? And here's what we do. As we told you, on one part of our screen are all the companies that have had great reactions to earnings. And the earnings were strong. I'm not talking about companies where their stocks went up nicely and their earnings stink. I'm not talking about no sales biotechs. And we've had a few of them actually rallying well. I'm talking about companies that did $1.5 billion sales last quarter, and they were only expected to do $1 billion. They made $1.50 a share, and they're only supposed to do 99 cents. And next quarter, they were supposed to do $1.25, and they've already guided to 175. And it breaks out and gaps up on heavy volume, and the group is, that's what I'm talking about. So I have it right on the front of my screen, and we're going to watch those babies closely. A bunch of them are in the artificial intelligence semiconductor area, and they also came down today. But we'll look for other things. Do you know Hyatt Hotels busted out on earnings? 140 to 160 before you can say boo? On better room rates and stuff? Things like that. What's going on? Where, why, how? And then, of course, as always, we close our eyes, hold our nose, and pray. And of course, as we always tell you, that doesn't work. So because we've tried it before and it just doesn't work. And if the market decides to really correct, because these are the leading stocks that did this reversal today, and maybe the market follows, that's all well and good. We'll pay very close attention. We've also wrote up the S&P since early November. That has yet to break our little green line of the 21-day moving average. And until it does, we're sticking. And if it wants to keep going another few months, we're good. And what's going on with the S&P? Well, there's other areas doing pretty darn well. Or well enough. The NASDAQ 100, riding up the 21-day also. If they break, we have something to think about. If they don't, we ride the rails. Remember what we tell you. We're looking for launching pads and uptrends as far as they want to go. And I think all that happened today is these stocks went vertical beyond the beyond. We went back into our little model books about breaking above that trend line and exhaustion buying, which usually occurs on the heaviest volume day where they gap them up and they finish you pretty darn down, and that's what happened today. But due to the fact we got monstrous cushion, we can be a little bit patient here, a little bit. And I will tell you, years ago, I wouldn't have been. But I've studied the model books of the triples and the quadruples and the tenfolds. I've never had a tenfold move. I'd like to have one. But in order to have a tenfold move, it's in the sitting. And every tenfold move had 20-25% corrections. But you were up 100% before it corrected. So maybe we're onto a few here. We'll know soon enough. You all have a great weekend. Drive carefully. When you get home, do like we do. It's quite simple. Make sure you hug your family, hug your children. They will feel better. You will feel better. I promise. Tomorrow, Fox News, 10 a.m. to noon, Neil Cavuto, I'll be on with him in the first hour. On Fox News, not Fox Business. Check it out. And until on Monday, peace out, all. Stay well, be well. Bye-bye.
This has been Investor's Edge with Gary Kaltbaum on BizTalk. To listen to past episodes or to get in contact with Gary, go to GaryK.com. That's GaryK.com.